Welcome to the PowerProtect Data Domain Controller Upgrade. In this video, we describe how the customer can keep using new products for better performance and capabilities while preserving existing data in storage. The next generation of the PowerProtect Data Domain Appliance provides DLH-based systems, dataless head. The controller upgrade is a scenario where we consider the cases when the controller and storage are separate entities, allowing for easy upgrade. This video shows how to upgrade your existing PowerProtect DD9900 controller to a new DD9910 while keeping the data shelves intact and preserving all the necessary system configurations. Other options are available to perform a controller upgrade to the DD9410. Here are some things you should know before attempting a controller upgrade. The supported scenarios include legacy DD controllers, DD6800, DD6900, DD9300, and DD9400, which can be upgraded to either the DD9410 or the DD9910. Other supported scenarios include the DD9800 and DD9900, which can be upgraded to the DD9910 controller. The DD9410 and DD9910 controllers will support the disk array enclosure models for the ES40 and the DS60 legacy shelves with 4TB or 8TB drives, along with the new DS600 DAE with 8TB drives. Because the DD9410s and DD9910s have included SAS-4 SSDs in the head unit for cache tier, the FS25 shelves are not supported in the controller upgrade. Record the configuration information of the source controller, such as passwords and passphrase, configurations of the network, and fiber channel ports. The storage will carry over the configuration data that enables the destination controller to take over the storage. The configuration data is stored on a dedicated partition on the first shelf, available for the destination controller after the storage is attached to the new controller. If the source system is configured with cloud tier, the upgrade target system must support cloud tier. In summary, we will prepare the source controller and the destination controller. Then remove the storage from the source controller and attach it to the destination controller. The power for attached shelves should remain powered on. Execute the command system head swap on the destination controller. The configuration data needed when using the storage, such as version, registry, license, security, historical databases, utilities, is saved periodically on the source controller and will be restored from the shelf to the destination controller during the head swap process. It is the DD configuration tool that saves the configuration data to the shelf of the source controller and restores the configuration data to the head unit on the destination controller. Note: after you enter the head swap command, the system displays a reminder that the passphrase for the old system is required if a passphrase was set on that system. You must type yes to continue. Open a console window on the source system and log into the Data Domain OS as sysadmin. When we enter the command system show model no, we see that the system is a DD9900. Whichever storage model you choose must be supported on both controllers, as the data on the storage that is accessible on the source controller must eventually be accessible to the destination controller. We then display the system's OS version number, which is Data Domain OS 8.0.0.0-109.4303. You will need to upgrade the DDOS version on the source controller to the same version that is running on the destination controller. When we enter the command disk show state, we can see on the source controller that there are 265 disks currently in use. When we enter the command enclosure show summary, you can view the type of enclosures along with the serial number of the enclosure and notice the current state is online. When we enter the command storage show all, we see that the active tier is 880.2 TIB and cache tier is 34.9 TIB and cloud tier is enabled with 261.9 TIB. When we enter the command filesysstatus, we can see that the file system is enabled and running and that this system is in an operational state. We now enter the command filesysdisable to disable the file system, enter yes to confirm, then press enter. When we disable the file system, it will then flush all the data to the external storage. The file system is now disabled. After checking our previous system output, we determined that the cache tier was using an FS25 shelf, which we won't need as the new controller has the cache tier disks within the head unit. Now we can enter the command storage remove enclosure 2. The enclosure is now successfully removed. We now enter the command support bundle create default to preserve the existing configuration. After the bundle is created, we power off the system and type yes to confirm. Once the source controller is powered down and before you power up the destination controller, move the SAS connections to the new controller. Remember the power for the attached shelves should remain powered on. Because some of the steps in this procedure are time consuming, it is good practice to perform this procedure on a day prior to the upgrade day. Write down the serial number on the back of the new system. The serial number is the default password for the sysadmin account on a new system. Leave the power on until the NVRAM batteries are fully charged. It can take up to 3 hours to fully charge the batteries. If possible, set up the new system on a workbench and connect the power cables. Otherwise, see the instructions in the rack mounting kit and install the system in either a temporary or permanent location in a rack. Note: HBA and I/O modules may not align from one controller model to another. Validate the HBA module placement with the installation procedure documents. Certain HBA modules cannot be moved to align with the controller being replaced. This necessitates manually reconfiguring settings for affected interfaces on the new controller. On the new controller, connect a console to the system and power on the system, then log in as sysadmin using the system serial number as the password. When the configuration utility starts up, enter Ctrl+C to exit the utility. Do not change the sysadmin account password now. When the configuration utility starts and asks to change the sysadmin password, at this time you can type no. When we enter the command system show model no, we see that this system is a DD9910. And when we display the version number, we see that it is data domain OS 8.0.0.0-109.4303, which is identical to the version of our source controller, the DD9900 system. When we enter the command disk show state, we see that all disks are in a foreign state. When we enter the command disk port show summary, we see that we have connected 2 SAS cables for each enclosure. When we enter the command system head swap, the system output reminds us that we are returning this system back to its prior operational conditions and that a reboot is required. It also reminds us that if a system passphrase was set on the old head, we'll need to do one of the following after the head swap operation completes. If we have encrypted data, we'll need to unlock the file system. If we don't have encrypted data, we'll need to set the system passphrase. At the prompt, we enter yes, then press enter. We're then prompted to enter the sysadmin password to run the head swap command. At this time, you will enter the system serial number as the current password. We're now restoring the system configuration. The system now reboots. Now log into the new controller with the previous set of credentials from the source controller. Notice that the destination controller has taken over the source hostname. We enter the command disk show state to see that the 256 disks are now in use. We enter the command disk port show summary to see that we have 2 SAS connections to each enclosure. We enter the command enclosure show summary to see the model numbers and serial numbers of the existing enclosures now belong to the new controller DD9910. We enter the command filesysstatus, which shows that the system is starting and may take some time. After the head swap, the file system will be started. We again enter the command filesysstatus, which shows that the system is disabled and shut down. Now that the file system has started, it can be enabled now. Enter the command filesysenable. The prompt then says, please wait. The prompt says, the file system is now enabled. Now that the file system is enabled, we need to add the cache tier. We then enter the command storage add tier cache enclosure 1 because the disks for the cache tier are included on the head unit they are located in enclosure 1 on the DD9910, eliminating the need to have an expansion shelf for cache tier disks. We then enter the command disk show state to see that the disks are now in use with the new controller. We then enter the command storage show all to compare the details of the system that were previously recorded, like active tier, cache tier, and cloud tier capacities. When the storage is attached to a new controller, the bind between the controller and the storage needs to be established so that the new controller can take ownership of the storage and be able to access the data shelves. New licenses are required for the destination controller. You must add these license keys after the controller upgrade. For the most up-to-date licensing information, see the DDoS release notes. In this video, we've shown how to perform a PowerProtect data domain controller upgrade. We hope this enables you to upgrade or replace your existing DD controllers with the latest data domain products while keeping your data preserved in place. Thank you for watching.